But he walked right in there. And he began to dance before the Lord with all of his might. What was he doing in the temple of God? He was showing that he received the ages that were to come. He received that it wouldn't be just a priest that would go before God, before the people. He received the part of God that where he could go and enter into that holy place. And he entered in before the time. Don't you know that Jesus tore down the middle wall of partition? That we might be able to enter into the presence of God freely and boldly. But notice how David did it way before the time. Understand this, child of the Most High. That's what this convention is all about. We're eating things that were for the ages that are to come. David did that that was unlawful in his day. And don't you know that this word of God that blows people's minds is unlawful for people to believe today. Ministry in times past, not these ministries that are here. They taught the people how to get ready to die. But the ministries that are rising up at this time are going to teach the ministry, teach the people how to live. There are many in the Christian church in the U.S. that want to die for Jesus. But who is it that wants to live for him? Jesus died that I wouldn't have to die. Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus wants to live in you. He wants to breathe in you. And he wants to have his being in you. And let me prophesy to you today. He doesn't ever have to die again. Oh, come on and worship him. Now we are bone of his bone. And flesh of his flesh. Amen. For 2 days, Jesus said, I did cures and miracles. How many knows he wasn't talking about being in the tomb? He didn't perform any miracles while he was in the tomb. So know that it was speaking of something other than him being in the tomb. It was speaking of one day with the Lord is 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is one day with the Lord. It has been 2,000 years since Jesus sat at the right hand of the power of God. For 2 days or 2,000 years, he's been doing cures and miracles. But he said on the third day, I will be perfected. I'm looking at a perfect church. He said he would be perfect. Does anybody know where he is now? Is he in your heart? Is he in your life? Do you understand? We just entered into the third day. The day that Christ will be perfected. Right in his church. Amen. In America, they teach that it's by the hair of our chinny chin chin that we're going to make it to heaven. That we got to do all we can do to just get there. We got to fight all these battles. Amen.
Amen.
We got to be sick. Everything will be better over there. And so here's the image of the bride of the Most High God. This is the image that I think that they're trying to show me. A bride with a sling in her arm, or a sling on her arm. A bride that has been shot up has bullet holes in her dress. A bride that's going to barely make it to heaven lame. But let me talk to you about the real bride that God saw me. The real bride is a glorious church without spot, wrinkle, and blemish. She shall be a perfect church. Jesus isn't getting no hag. He's getting a beautiful bride who you and I are. Come on, give him a hand clap today. Amen. Turn your neighbor and say, I'm not no hag. He's given me power over all the power of the devil. That nothing by any means can hurt me. Why is the devil around? So I can have power over him. Why is the devil here? So I'd have something to rule over. Why is the devil here? So I can take authority over him. Why is the devil here? So I can bruise his head. He bruised mine. He bruised our heel. We're about to bruise his head. Come on, magnify Jesus. Turn your neighbor and say, we're going to do some devil stopping. Amen. God is going to teach his church how to win every battle and how to walk on serpents and scorpions. I'm a different kind of preacher, as you probably already know. I'm a preacher that doesn't like to play games with people. I'm a preacher that seeks God for truth. I'm a preacher that wants to see somebody reach their destiny in God. I'm a preacher that wants to see you reach your full potential into the God that is to come. And I believe that this is the day that his church is going to do some things that are unlawful to this hour. And we're going to enter into this God that is to come. We're going to enter into the truth. That part of God that hasn't been revealed to this church hour. We're going to begin to enter like David entered. We're going to eat things that are unlawful today. And God is going to give us great power. Come on, give him praise. I remember hearing of a story of a little girl. Who was drawing a picture on her kitchen table. And she had all the colors. And Mama said to her, what are you drawing, sweetheart? And she said, I'm drawing a picture of God. And Mama said, You can't draw a picture of God. You've never seen God. And the daughter said, I'm not finished yet, Mama. But when I'm done, you'll see my finished picture. If you will allow me in this convention, I've just got my Crayolas out. And I'm making a total picture that this generation might behold their God. Amen. John said, Beloved, what manner of love has he bestowed upon us? That he would call us the mighty sons of God. That it does not matter what we shall be. But we know that when he appears, we shall be just like him. Come on, magnify Jesus. And I believe that this is the day that Zambia is going to see receive their appearing. That as they see him, we're going to put on the nature that he has shown us. It's here little. And it's there little.
Where they asked Jesus, why does your disciples not prophet.
Praise the Lord. Because he spoke to them while, even I am with them, him being the bridegroom. The disciple can't miss a meal. Jesus had much to impart into his disciples. But there was a time when they would fast. How many knows we're not justified by the laws of men? We're not justified by the fastings that the Pharisees want us to do. We are justified by faith. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're justified by faith. Not what you do, but by faith. And there's only one way that faith comes. Faith comes by hearing God. And that hearing comes from the Word of God. And how many knows that Jesus Christ is the Word of God? In 1992, Jesus came into my car and said, I am the Word of God that has fallen upon your hearing. I want you to begin to hear me. I thought it wasn't just good words. I found it out. I thought it wasn't just abstaining from something. But you're not justified because you don't drink. You're not justified because you don't smoke. You're not justified because you go to church every Sunday. You're not justified because you have a sale meeting. You are justified by the hearing of faith. That is the only way that we are justified. Whatever falls upon our ears, this is how we begin to walk out what we've been justified with. Many are struggling today in ministry. But I wonder if it's ministry that God gave them. Or if it's self-made ministry. Amen. Self-made ministry is going to perish. Amen. Jesus said, every man's work through Paul will be tried as with fire. Whosoever's work remaineth is his reward. But whosoever's work perishes, it's for the saving of his soul. Some people are going to suffer loss, but it's because for the saving of their soul. Jesus said that the angels of God are, or those that are born of the kingdom, are just like the angels of God. And they don't marry and are giving in marriage. The only thing I've been taught about that is, amen, people getting divorced and remarried, there's none of that in heaven. But can I tell you what God really meant through Christ Jesus? By what he said? It's like a bank that is about to go under. They should just go ahead and close shop. But instead of closing shop, a bigger bank buys them out. This is marrying and then giving in marriage. With ministry who started out by themselves, God ordained them to die. Or their ministry to come to an end. They join big networks. And the networks help them stay alive. There are several ministries that the only reason why they're on TBN is because TBN is paying the bill. Is this all right? They merged, they married TBN. But maybe they have an old ministry that should die. No man drinking the old wine desires that is brand new. We are living in a brand new hour. An hour when the old is going to have to go down, while the brand new ministry is going to be pouring. And those that are still drinking the old wine are going to perish with the using of it. Come on, help me. Amen. Anybody wants some new ones? There's a difference between new wine and old wine. I'm not an alcoholic, but I'm going to tell you something. I'm not a lush or a drunk, but I'm going to tell you something. Amen. New wine is different than old wine. And Jesus left this for an illustration for us. What was Jesus doing talking about wine? Don't you know you're not supposed to do that? But here's Jesus talking about wine. And don't you know Israel called him a wine bibber? Why do you suppose he was called a wine bibber? It's because he knew about wine. What was his first miracle? Turning water into wine. Praise the Lord. There were six water pots. Amen. At that first wedding, six is the number of men. Man that is filled with 98% water. But when God is through with you, he's going to cause the water to turn into spirit. Praise the Lord. And the latter wine shall be greater than the former. You see, according to tradition at the time of Jesus, the best wine was served first. So everybody would be drunk and tipsy. So when they brought in the cheap wine, everybody was already tipsy that they didn't know that it was new, that it was the new wine. The cheap wine. Amen. But here came Jesus, turning the water into wine. And the latter wine was greater than the former. Turn to your neighbor and say, we're living in the last day. Thank God for what Jesus did. But thank God for what he's about to pour into this hour. Turn to your neighbor and say, thank God for some new wine. Amen. Now it's interesting, he speaks of this garment that doesn't agree with the new garment. You can't take old time religion and make it agree with what God's doing today. You can't take old time Pentecost. They will not agree with those that will tabernacle with God. Amen. The hour of Passover was at the time of Moses. The hour of Pentecost was at the time of Jesus. But the hour of those that shall tabernacle with God is right now. Pentecost is getting ready to die. Pentecost is the old garment. Pentecost will not agree with this message. Amen. Why? Because they're still drunk on the old wine. Oh man that drinks the old wine desires that is brand new. Why? Because they pitch their tent short of the glory of God that is to come. This preacher is not going to pitch his tent short. I've been praying for 12 years. I've been asking the Father, Lord, help me move with your spirit into whatever new thing you're bringing. Don't you know that, behold, he's doing a brand new thing. And it shall spring forth. Amen. It shall spring forth. Praise the Lord. Give Jesus a praise. In the kingdom of God, I wish I had three chairs here. I want to teach something. But in the kingdom of God, amen. There is righteousness, peace, and joy. Jesus says, when Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob come into the kingdom of God, and you yourselves are thrust out. Amen. How many knows that in the kingdom of God there's righteousness? Abraham is the father of righteousness. But Abraham brought forth hope, which was Isaac. Now somebody say Isaac. But Isaac brought forth charity, which was Jacob. Amen. So these three chairs, right now there's just two, but we're just going to say abracadabra and another one will appear. Amen. You put it over here, my brother. So this right here is the kingdom of our God. Amen. In the kingdom of God is Father, Son, Holy Ghost. In the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. Amen. How many knows there's faith, hope, and love? Everything that brings power comes in threes. Three is the number of completion. God is going to bring a completion into the church. Now, the oneness people, those that believe in one God only, they say Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are sitting on one throne. But the Trinity people, they say it's Father, Son, Holy Ghost sitting on three thrones. Both have a small revelation. Amen. God is one God. But he was manifested with Father. And the Father ruled for 4,000 years. Right here. And Pentecost happened. But then Jesus came in and he began to rule. And Pentecost was birthed. And he ruled for 3.5 years. But now we're living in the age of the Holy Ghost, where it is the Holy Ghost that is reigning. For 4,000 years,
amen,
the Father was looking for somebody to bring forth one son in his image and after his likeness. But the only way he could bring forth one is to cause a young girl who never knew no man to be found with the child of the Holy Ghost. And now the Son is in the earth. Amen. Born of the seed of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
And all of a sudden, at the age of 12, which is the number for sonship, he begins to astonish the scribes and the Pharisees. I astonish scribes and Pharisees often with what I teach. But between the age of 12 and the age of 30, is 18 long years. 18 is the number of tribulation. Jesus through tribulation. The Bible said that he learned obedience through the things that he suffered. Don't you ever think you're going to do something for God unless you learn obedience from the things you
suffer.
Turn to your neighbor and say, there's only one way for you to learn. As that at times you're going to make mistakes. But say, sweetheart, just learn. I told you last night, David said, blessed is the man in whom God does not impute sin. But instead of imputing unto us sin, this is his teaching process.
Amen.
So, 18 has three numbers in it. 18 is the number 6 plus 6 plus 6. Amen.
Amen.
That he walked through tribulation in body, soul, and spirit.
Hallelujah.
And then he was empowered at the age of 30. 30 is the number of full stature. At the age of 30, Jesus reached full maturity. And then the one that astonished the scribe and the Pharisee at the age of 12, at the age of 30, was endowed with power from on
high.
And his ministry began at the age of
30.
Praise the Lord. All right. But here is the age of the Holy Ghost. Now Jesus is our Savior, right?
Yes.
And his Father is the creator of all things. And Jesus said, you can blaspheme the Father and be forgiven. You can even blaspheme the Son who paid the price for your redemption.
But you can't blaspheme the Holy Ghost. For you will not be forgiven in this lifetime. Understand that Jesus was standing in this chair right here when he said this lifetime. That if we blaspheme the Holy Ghost, we can't be forgiven in this time or this age or in the age that is to come, which is the age of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Now we see Peter after the day of Pentecost. Now Peter is now in this chair. And he's beginning to prophesy. He's no longer tossed to and fro. No, he's endued with power. And the day of Pentecost represented a day where everyone brought their offerings to God. Everyone was to sell everything and bring their offering to Peter. But two did not bring their total offering. Ananias and Sapphira. Amen. When Ananias came in, amen, she told Peter, I gave everything. But Peter said, you lied to the Holy Ghost. Now let me ask you something here. She lied to Peter, right? When Peter asked the question, did you give everything? What did she answer? She said, oh yeah. Right? But Peter said, you lied to the Holy Ghost. Anybody hearing this?
Yes.
So when you lie to the man of God with the Holy Ghost, you don't only lie to the man, but you lie to the Holy Ghost. I'm not here because of my own will. I paid a price to be here. I spent many hours in travel to be here. Amen.
Amen.
The crowds aren't massive right now. But I thank God for those that have the hearing of faith. That want to learn something more than just get saved, get married, get dead, go to heaven. That's baby steps. Baby steps. When I was a child, I did those things that children do. But now that I'm a man, I threw away all my childish things. I threw away that childish language. And I began to stand up and be a man. And I became accountable for everything that I said. Praise the Lord. In Isaiah 22:22, amen, has the keys to bind and to loose, or the keys of the kingdom. Amen. I want us to turn there real quick.
Isaiah
22. So much to say, so little time. How we do it on time? Is anybody happy? Somebody's learning something. This word is not for the babies. This word is for those that want to grow up and walk with God. Does anybody want to walk with God?
and the keys of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder. So he shall open, and none shall shut. And he shall shut, and none shall open. Do you know that we have the power to open and shut? Within your hands, if you receive the keys of the kingdom, you have power to put your hands to a new business. You have power to open up a door into the spirit. You have the power to close the door to the kingdom of the devil and to unlock the kingdom of heaven in somebody's life. And I will fasten him as a nail in a sure place. And he shall be for a glorious name to his father's house. And they shall hang upon him a glory of his father's house. The offering and the issue. The vessels of small quantity. The vessels of cups. Even the vessels of flagons. Vessels of flagons are wine bottles. Before we go to this next part, real quick, I want to tell you that the new wine had to be poured into new bottles. You don't pour old wine in new bottles. The revelation of the new wine. New wine breathes. New wine burps. New wine has breath. New wine is alive. New wine is always processing. Old wine just sits on a chair waiting for Jesus to come. Anybody hear me? Old wine makes excuses of why the devil has them. Old wine is getting old and brittle in their pews. But those that have brand new wine are alive. They breathe with the Spirit. Always processing the Spirit. They're always alive. Somebody said, I'm always alive. And you'll never have to die. Unless you want to be that old wine. Old wine just sits on the shelf. I do some remodeling on houses, and that's not a mistake. I repaint. I put up doors. Whatever a new old house needs, I make it brand new. That's what I do for a living. More so then than now. Now I'm making old bottles new bottles. I'm making it new out of those that have been in an old time thing. And let me tell you, I know how to remodel. Amen.
Amen.
Now understand that the bottles were always made out of goats. Somebody say goats. Does not the goat represent the power of the devil? And the goat had to be sacrificed. It was a supreme sacrifice for the animal. But they took those skins and they scraped out all the flesh to after where there was no flesh. Do you understand what God is doing in our lives? He's scraping out all the flesh. He's scraping out Pentecostal flesh. He's scraping out charismatic order flesh. He's scraping out Baptist flesh. And what will he do? He will pour in his new wine. Praise the Lord. Now ceremonially, they took the kidney of the animal and they burned the kidney separate on fire and placed it on fire. The kidney has a lot of fat around it. According to the Ancient of Days, those that were ancient, the kidney represented the trying of the heart. Now we can understand that God tries the reins of the hearts of his people. And let me tell you that he's going to pull out those reins. He's going to pull out of us all of that flesh. He's going to take out of us an old spirit. And he's going to put into us a brand new spirit. To where we breathe. Where we stay alive. And where we have our being in him. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Now with that, right here. Verse 25. In the day, saith the Lord of hosts, shall the nail that is fastened in the sure place be removed. And shall be cut down and fall. And the burden that was upon it shall be cut off. For the Lord has spoken. Now what is this talking about? How many knows that there was a day where we put all our burdens upon Jesus? But what is this declaring? Unto the one that receives the keys of the kingdom, God is going to pull them out of that sure place where they've been hanging. And they're going to have to begin to walk with the old burden. In Galatians chapter 6, it says, let every man bear his own burden. When I was a child, I let Jesus bear it. But now that I'm a man, I bear my own burden. Praise the Lord. The Bible says that he that bears his own burden has rejoicing in himself. And he that doesn't bear his own burden has rejoicing in somebody else. While we're coming down from prayer, I'm preaching the message of perfection. While we're always in need, when we receive from ministry, our rejoicing is in the ministry. When we have to get a miracle from ministry, our rejoicing is for the ministry. When the ministry gives us a word from God, our rejoicing is for the ministry. But when we get our own word of God, our rejoicing is in ourselves. When we receive our own miracle that didn't come from the hands of another, we have rejoicing in ourselves. When no one has to prop us up anymore, we have rejoicing in ourselves. When we don't have to go to others for prayer, and we have our own prayer life now, we have rejoicing in ourselves. When I was a child, did those things that were childish. But when I became a man, I began to walk like a man, and talk like a man. And I placed my own burden upon myself. Come on, magnify Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's time to grow up. I don't believe I'm talking to the immature Christian. I believe I'm talking to a mature one. God did not bring this message today to immaturity. He brought this message today for those that are growing up to begin to bear their own burden, to bear their own yoke. Amen. Even the yoke for others. Amen. Come on, magnify Jesus. I feel his anointing. I feel his love. Come on, worship him. Come on, magnify him. Stand up on your feet with me. Stand up all across this place. And I want you to take one person by the hand. Take one person by the hand. Take one person by the hand. Just one person. Look face to face at them. And I want you to pray for that individual. I want you to pray for maturity. I want you to pray for strength for that one. I want you to pray for faith for that one. I want you to pray that they're able to take their own burden now. That they might walk with God and talk with God and have their being with God. I want to hear somebody praying tonight. Come on, worship him. Oh, magnify Jesus. Let the Lord hear the prayers of the saints. for you. I heard the Lord say you're going out of this place with even greater maturity. Even greater. Even with what you came in with, you're going to be greater. Even in these meetings. You're one that I spoke about even in the beginning. There's a wealth that is being imparted into us in this conference, in this convention. Father, I thank you so much for the wealth that is being poured into your ministries, God. I thank you for something great. I thank you that she's going to lead the people all the way across, Lord, into the promised land, Father. I thank you for great maturity, God, great wealth on the other side, Lord. Amen. Just seek him. Amen. While he might be found, surely Jesus is coming, and he has his reward with him. He's coming into your life, and he's coming. He's coming. He's coming. Amen. He's going to give you all the tools of evangelism. He's going to give you tools for the ministry. He's going to equip you. Father, I thank you so much, Lord. Come on, worship Jesus. Come on, magnify him. Magnify him. Glory to God. Come on, worship him. Let holy prayer go up in this place.
greater walk with God. Don't you feel it? I'm prophesying we're going to have something great. We're going to walk out of these meetings with us in the name of Jesus. Come on, worship Him. Come on, magnify Him. Praise the Lord. If Jesus is a great big head, how many is going to come? Amen. Tonight, this afternoon, and invite several people. Amen. I love Jesus. I love Him with all my heart. I want to minister tomorrow. We don't have no time. Amen. How many said it? Amen. Spend your lunch hour in prayer. Amen. We need to do some fasting and pray. And God will really pour out something great. I didn't come from America to play games. I didn't come from America just to see somebody healed.
Oh, manu ilumika na nomba mcheni cha bashukuru.
Go ahead.
Let's give the Lord a big
greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
First of all, my wish was that I should be with you from the beginning of the conference. I was here around 10 hours. Unfortunately, things could not work out the way things were supposed to happen. And then, as you may be aware, we've just lost one of our other men who used to be, he was a counselor, later on became a mayor, and then he was accorded the dignity of Adaman. The dignity of Adaman meant that he was a life member of the council. So I had to attend that funeral to make a speech. And I was expected to make a speech, so I was entangled. Much as I wanted to be here, and I was also required to be there. Thank God that I have given me this opportunity to come and share with you what I've got for you. In the first place, I wanted maybe to attend this conference because I know the theme of the conference is one of the questions that I usually ask myself. I always ask myself, what is my destiny? I always ask myself, what is the destiny of Ndola? We would like to know where is the destiny of Ndola. If each one of us ask this question, I think we'll find a solution to the problem that Ndola is going through. So I thought I should come here so that we can come and share this theme and ensure that we think about it very deeply. Let me just go to my written speech. The Master of Ceremony, the Chairman of the Coordinating Committee, the visiting pastors, Brian and Brian Dickerson, invited pastors, Christian fraternity, may I simply say my fellow Christians, I wish to express my gratitude for the invitation to grace the first ever Your Destiny Conference in Zambia. To begin with, allow me to join in warmly welcoming the guests, Pastor Brian and Barari Dickerson to Zambia, and particularly to the friendly city of Ndola. I hope, time permitting, our guests will be able to visit some of the tourist attractions centered in Ndola. Offers like the Kupadot Museum and the Nyagamashot Memorial Site, where the late Nyagamashot crash plane happened, the one who was the UN Secretary General. I have been informed that your four-day destiny conference under the theme Getting Hold of Your Destiny has been arranged essentially to equip Christian believers in attendance with the skills to facilitate your application of biblical principles in your day-to-day lives. Since man is born with the inherent ability to influence and effect positive changes in its course of life, it is important, therefore, that meetings like this one are able to revive that sense of purpose. Because the moment you forget about yourself, even God will also forget about you. God will always remember you if you remember yourself. So each day you should ask yourself, what is my destiny? Then God will be giving you your destiny. Additionally, and by and large, Christians gathering of this nature should be encouraged because they afford brothers and sisters moments to reflect collectively on their spiritual well-being. It is also time to educate, learn, and above all, encourage one another to soldier on as God's messengers. Allow me to briefly touch on the government and the church relationship. I want to reiterate my government's firm position on the role the church plays in supplementing government efforts in addressing the social problems, such as poverty and disease affecting a cross section of the family today.
I know our major problem that we are encountering now is poverty. So as Christians, we should reflect on ourselves. Why has this poverty affected us? In particular, in Ndola, or particularly in your household? Then if you ask yourself, I know with the thing that we have, if you recognize your destiny, why has God put you? Then I'm sure it's quite easy to fight poverty. I know poverty is something that has brought a lot of things like illness. Even oppression is coming from poverty. Because if there's poverty at home, there's very much less concentration in education, and so oppression will continue to be there. Apart from the spiritual guidance, the church is known for many times. We are privileged to receive or witness occasions when the church goes out of its way to generously donate to the needy members of our communities. This moral obligation is highly commendable. And just goes to indicate that the church and government are partners in tackling social economic difficulties people face. With these few words, I don't know whether there are few words, but in political circles, these are few words. Because we speak maybe 2 hours, that's when we say, no, at least I've spoken. With these few words, brothers and sisters in Christ, and now, I don't know whether it's the opening, but I would say I bless this conference to be successful so that God's blessing will be poured upon the people who are here, and in return, they will understand and identify their destiny. And after that, we shall also establish the destiny of Ndola as a city. So that Ndola can be a prosperous town. I know people are always speaking Ndola of a ghost town, but we are now saying Ndola is no longer a ghost town. I'm seeing, actually, I've been praying to God, I'm a man of God, actually. I've been praying to God that, no, God, please answer the people of Ndola. Let there be prosperous. I'm sure God is not going to understand. Ndola once again, be revitalized, and it will establish its destiny. Thank you very much.
Let us clap our hands for that power.
For those powerful words,
amen. Amen.
Amen.
Let's all say, Zambia must be saved.
Say
Ndola is on the move.
Amen.
Amen. There's no dead city in Zambia. Every city is alive.
Amen.
Those that were about to die, they were just there because they were kind of passing through the valley. But we are coming up the hill and we are getting onto the mountain. Amen. The mayor, sir, we thank you very much for believing with us, standing in faith for your testing conference in Zambia. This is the best ever, which we believe is a stepping stone into greater other conferences, which will help people begin to know who they are, people begin to know where they are going, where they are, and why they live. It is true, as Christians, we are not just